Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here, still in the great state of South Carolina. Praise be God in the highest. Hey, brothers and sisters, hope you guys are doing all right. I'm doing pretty good down here. It's been record hot here. It's been like 83 degrees. I think today it's 82 this afternoon here. Well, praise God, you know. I'm just laughing because, you know, this time of year, it's funny that it's so hot. But, you know, God is such a good God. He blesses us so much. He's just a great God. You know, that's what I'm thinking about. You know, I just want to tell you, the video I wanted to make, I got something on my hand. I didn't. I wanted to make a video about, talk about the deceptions of Satan, you know, and just mention that. Of course, we give all praise and glory to God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, who was and is to come. But, you know, the enemy loves to deceive us. And that's why I would like to recommend to you guys, while I'm thinking about it, Carmen, the singer Carmen. He's got cancer now, by the way. As a matter of fact, if you know who he is, pray for him. It's C-A-R-M-A-N, Carmen. He's a singer. That's his first name. And he's an awesome guy. And he has lots of videos. You can watch his videos. His children love his videos, teenagers, even grown people, old people. Everybody loves Carmen's videos. I had a chance to go see him sing when I first started in the ministry with a church group, and I didn't even know who he was, so I didn't go. And later on, I found out, man, I really missed an opportunity. And I pray that he's going to recover, because he is a mighty gift to the body of Christ. And by the grace of God, I get to see him when he comes back. He's supposed to be doing another tour when he recovers. As a matter of fact, there's a brother who had given me a ticket, but even to go backstage and meet Carmen, but his concert was delayed because he's having his chemotherapy. So I ask you guys to pray for Carmen. He's a great man. And you go look at his videos. So the videos I want to talk about is Slam. It's talking about spiritual warfare. A lot of his videos are spiritual warfare. He does rock themes, country themes, you know, even hip-hop themes for young people, all kinds of stuff. You know, JC's in the house, Jesus Christ is in the house, all this kind of stuff. It's great. You know, all age groups. He does country songs too. And he has awesome videos. So Slam, and there's another one, Satan Bite the Dust, and there's other ones too. Great God, as I just mentioned, I didn't even realize it when I said, I mean, he's a great God. That is a Carmen song also. How about that? He is a great God. And that song is also great. The video is great. It talks about the Dark Ages. In the song, there's video to the great God. It shows the Middle Ages. It shows, you know, the bishop and the prince or the duke in that area being evil, corrupt people, and then trying to stop this. Carmen plays like a priest who's trying to get the word of God to the people, teaching the people, you know, the gospel in their native language. And then, of course, as it happened through all out the ages from like 600 AD, you know, until 1700 AD, the Catholic Church would kill anybody that would try to, give people the gospel in their native language. As a matter of fact, William Penn, you know, he got in trouble with the Anglican Church, which is just the British branch of Roman Catholicism at that time, the Church of England. You know, William Penn got in trouble for teaching the Lord's Prayer. He was a school teacher or whatever, and he taught the Lord's Prayer to the children in English. And then he got in trouble. You know, that's how he ended up coming to the New World, to the North America. Anyway, brothers and sisters, there's so many little wacky little details like that that are in my mind. What can I tell you? You know, I don't know. You know, I guess I like to play Trivial Pursuit way back when it was popular when I was a teenager and stuff. I guess it kind of stuck with me, I guess. Majoring in all those trivial things. What can I tell you? Everybody's brain works differently. But anyway, I just want to tell you that he's a good God and a great God, and the enemy is a liar and a deceiver, brothers and sisters. He is a liar and a deceiver, a tricker. Everything he does is smoke and mirrors, brothers and sisters. If you go look at the story of Job, Satan's power, Satan is the controlled opposition. Satan entered Judas in order that Judas might betray the Lord, as God knew his heart was bad, and God preordained and selected Judas to be one of the disciples because the Lord knew he had a bad heart. The Lord knew that he was corrupt and that Judas would betray the Lord. So therefore, you know, Judas was entered by Satan, the Bible says. In John, Satan entered Judas when he sopped the bread with Jesus at the Last Supper. Satan entered him. Judas went out, and then it was night. So darkness represents, you know, wickedness and evil. And you know, I was just thinking today, the Lord is just reminding me, I was looking at an article about this chemtrails they spray in there. If you don't know anything about it, go look it up. Like, what in the world are they spraying? Why in the world are they spraying? That's the name of two documentaries that I know about these chemtrails they spray. And what I was just reading an article. There was a scientist guy, who did an article about it, talking about them doing it. A new article about it, and he references all these documentaries about it. And what I'd already heard in the past, and it was in this article again, that since they've been doing the chemtrails and all that, now we have what they call global dimming. 20% or more of the sunlight is being reflected away because of these chemtrails and all that. And some of it may be, you know, attributed to pollution also. There's no doubt there is pollution, you know. But, of course, the global warming is a scheme to, you know, climate change is a scheme to bring in a global carbon tax to support the Antichrist kingdom. John Rockefeller wrote about in the 1960s, some of these other guys, these Illuminati, Kissinger and all those guys, so they write, you know, like their papers, like Hitler wrote My Struggle, Mein Kampf, and then all of these wicked people write books of what they're going to do, what's their plans. So these Illuminati people, they invented the idea of Earth Day. They want people to worship Mother Earth, and then they also want to create a, you know, this climate tax, these taxes, to support their one world government. So it's a win-win for them, even though there is pollution. It, you know, it's a deception. It's partly true, but yet they take it and twist it for their own gain. See, that's an example of what I'm talking about, of deception of the enemy. But anyway, there's a global darkening. There's a dimming of the earth in the natural, brothers and sisters. So just like all those of you who've watched my video since I've been started, you know, the Lord led me. I had a dream. And I was fighting all these different demons and defeating them, no problem. I ran through, you know, like an army. Some of my dream, I was like in an army and there were people shooting guns. It was the enemy and everybody was afraid. But I said, you know, I felt led by the Lord to run through there. The bullets didn't even hurt me. I was able to defeat them, go on and on. Finally, at the end, I was not able to defeat, even though he didn't defeat me, but I was unable to kill with a sword this big demon. And then I told this dream before, and then the demon, or this, you know, it was like a big wicked giant, then he turned into a woman, and then he started trying to kiss me, and then, you know, instead of attacking me physically, trying to seduce me. And then I was like, what in the world is this? Crazy, this is sick. Who are you? And he said, I'm Baphomet. And I'd never heard really a Baphomet before. I'd heard the name once. I didn't really know anything about it. I looked it up, and Baphomet is really, brothers and sisters, the spirit that's on the world in the end times. And Baphomet has female breast, but yet it has a male's private parts, phallic symbol, you know, and it's really like the snakes, the caduceus, really. It's like the, you know, like the symbol for a medical, you know, it's a staff with the two snakes around it. It's the private parts. Of course, the two snakes, actually, in higher level interpretation, those snakes represent DNA, brothers and sisters. And I made videos about all this deep stuff and all these different meanings of what that stuff means before. But part of the Baphomet, he's got one hand up and one hand down. And you'll see pictures even of George. There is even a statue of George Washington in Washington, D.C., wearing like a toga, a Greek toga. And then he's got one hand up and one hand down, making this as above, so below sign. You will see these Santa Ninos, these statues of the baby Jesus that are idols and are worshipped in the Philippines and lots of other countries. They worship this baby Jesus called the Santa Nino. He's doing the as above, so below symbol. So you see all this stuff. So, and he's got these Latin words like coagulate and whatever. I forgotten. I haven't looked at it in a long time. But anyway, the point is to break down and then build something new. Take apart and build something new. So of course, it's about the new world order. But the as above, so below is what I'm trying to get at with this branch I'm running down here, to go to the fact that the dimming is below. We see there is a literal darkness coming on the earth. But at the same time, you know, it's as above, so below. Just as God says, the devil perverts everything God does, brothers and sisters. If you haven't seen my video, I'm running through it again. God said, Jesus said, let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So, you know, Adam and Eve were a reflection of God. Adam is the image of God, created in the image of God. And Eve, here we are, you know, as a reflection of God. And then they sinned, they fell, and then they really became a reflection of Satan and the fact that they disobeyed God. They rebelled against God. Therefore, God said, when you eat the fruit, you'll surely die. The devil said, no, God doesn't want you to eat it because you'll become like him. Same lie I always like to add this in. You know, the Mormons tell people if you do good in your life, you can become a god. God was a man who lived on a planet who did great and became a god. Jesus was a man who did what God said and he became a god. And there's multiple gods and multiple gods and all these, you know, these supposed prophet, you know, there's one leader of the Mormon church who is their high prophet, you know, and they have a council of 12 and all this. And those prophets have said this stuff since Mormonism started. All these quotes they've made and additions and writings they made about the Book of Mormon and the doctrines and covenants and all this stuff. And so this is what they believe, that you become a god straight from the Garden of Eden. The same lie and deception that Satan told Eve. He deceived her. Did God really say don't eat the fruit? All of these things, subtle deceptions. Because Satan wants things on earth to be like the second heaven, where he abodes, where these powers and principalities and forces of darkness are. You know, lots of people have the misconception that Satan is in hell. He's not in hell yet. He's in the second heaven, and he has powers and principalities. Here's a biblical reference, even besides I'm quoting one, that's one there, these powers and principalities and forces of darkness in high places. But when Daniel had prayed and fasted for 21 days, Gabriel finally came to him after 21 days and said, I've been trying to come to you since the moment you started praying, but the prince of Persia withstood me. And then until Michael, your prince, that's the archangel Michael, the Bible calls these power, you know, principality. Prince is the head of a principality. So there's principalities of holy angels in authority like Michael, and his principality is over Israel. And then you have principalities that are like the prince of Persia, you know, who was an evil fallen angel who was withstanding Gabriel, who was a messenger angel. So, you know, and so he finally, you know, Michael had to come and break through so that Gabriel could come to Daniel. Anyway, brothers and sisters, why was that? Because the territory of Persia was evil. Therefore, it was under the reign of a spiritual second heaven principality of a wicked fallen angel, because it was a wicked fallen country. And then here's Daniel, prophet of God, who was in Persia. He was in the territory of that fallen angel, brothers and sisters. That's why when you go from country to country, like myself, as an anointed servant of God, when I go to countries, I can discern and feel the spiritual warfare and the spiritual authority in that place. So when I go to the Bible Belt, you know, there's lots of fake Christians and all that. We know there's lots of hypocrites and fake Christians. But there are more Christians concentrated in the Bible Belt of the United States, really, than any other place on earth. So when I'm here, I can feel that. I can feel that there's many Christians. I can feel the level of evil. And it has much increased since I left the States in 2007. I'll say that. But you can go to other parts of the country. As an example, Las Vegas. Or I can go to LA. All these other places I've been to. And you can feel that level of evil is much higher. San Francisco. Well, of course, we all know about that. Philippines. Huge. But the anointing of evil in the Philippines, of course, is all from the idolatry. The Filipino people are much more, you know, innocent and less, you know, wise and evil in the ways that a lot of, you know, Americans are, especially in your big cities, in your blue states. You have much more wicked and knowing better people. Where in the Philippines, you have lots of ignorant people that don't know better than what they're doing. You see what I'm saying? So God is unlike the law, as they quote, ignorance of the law is no excuse. But with God, it is. When you don't know, you know, what God wants from you, and you've never, you know, you can't read and write and all that. God doesn't hold us accountable for things we don't know. But once we know, as the Bible says, there's a Bible verse. It says that, you know, to him who knows to do and doesn't do it, it is sin. So those who do, you know, those who know better and then do it anyway, like Americans, almost all Americans have heard the gospel. All Americans know, you know, this country was founded as a Christian nation. We have a Christian background, almost everybody, even in those fallen areas, the worst fallen areas of the United States. They were very Christian before. People knew the King James language and knew the King James Bible and all that. It was a common thing to quote the Bible. If you were to talk to people, even in New York City, even in Boston, all these other places, 100 years ago, 150 years ago, very different culture than where we live in today, brothers and sisters. We are living in a fallen, dark, much darker and fallen world than what we inherited here in the United States, brothers and sisters. And that is unique. Every country, some countries, lots of countries have never been in the light. Of course, in the Middle East, brothers and sisters, they were in the light. The gospel was taken there first. There was no Islam until about 600 AD, 516 AD, whatever it was, when Muhammad started having his convulsions and seizures and possession and channeled that spirit that they used to write down you know, the words that he said, because he couldn't read and write. It was channeled through him. And so prior to that, there, you know, there was no Islam. So Christianity was in all those areas until, you know, the conquest from the followers of Muhammad later on. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so the darkness is really increasing in the natural and in the spiritual, as above, so below. So as I've told you before, and you know, and I just want to thank the Lord too. The books have been going. The books, someone had sent me a postcard. The books have been going out, praise God, more and more and more. I've got I don't know how many books have been going out, brothers and sisters, a lot. And I thank God for that because, you know, this book is really the message that people need to hear, that the Lord gave me, that will set you, you know, this got the ingredients for a revival in here. You know, the Lord has been giving me dreams, and then I've been getting words when I've been praying in the Spirit. I've been getting words from the Lord that it's, you know, the rapture is close. The Lord is at hand. It's time for us to depart, brothers and sisters, so soon. And as I mention all the time, there is a certain amount of people that need to get saved. The fullness of the Gentiles. That's what we're waiting on, brothers and sisters, for the last person to get saved that needs to be saved. And so, yes, I've said and I know in my heart from the Lord, America will not repent. But the bride is going to get brighter and brighter and set on fire. Just like in 2011, a bunch of you guys, you know, I thank the Lord for it. It's really a revival. But it's just, you know, it's just not concentrated in what, it's not like in a church, but it's spread out through the internet and social media and all that. There are millions of people that got woke up in 2011. I came to the Lord and the Lord woke me up and called me to the ministry in 2000. And I already thought things were like that were so bad. It's a million times worse than it was then. And then the amount of people that are talking about the end times is a million times more than it was then in 2000. The growth of the amount of people who are aware and awake that we are living in the last days has grown significantly, brothers and sisters. So what I'm trying to tell you, I'm talking about this darkness so that there might be someone who sees this video that's not awake, that doesn't realize that. And I'm giving all these, you know, spiritual insight to those people who are thinking, you know, in those natural ways and seeing things from the outside, you know, and this is what's going on, an explanation for what's going on in the world that we see in the natural. Brothers and sisters, but if God be for us, who can be against us? You know, God is with us. He is Emmanuel, God with us. He is always with us. He will never leave us nor forsake us. He's going to take us home, brothers and sisters. We must press forward to the high calling, to the mark of the high calling of Christ Jesus that's in our lives. As it says in Hebrews, strengthen the feeble knees. You know, make your feet straight. Don't let them go out of the path. Stay on the call and on the mark of what God gave you. And when you make a mistake, as it says, we have an advocate with the Father, even the Lord Jesus. 1 John 1:9, if we, the church, confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So if you sin, confess it. Confess his word. You know, I have lots of people message me and say, I've repented and repented and repented, but I don't think God's forgiven me. Dear brother or sister, or dear, what do they say? What's the one that people love to quote? Beloved. Have you ever seen that Rabbi Schneider on TBN? He keeps saying, Beloved, which is from the Bible. Think about it this way. The next time you're doing that, think about this. God is not a man that he should lie. And when we're saying that the Lord's blood is not good enough for us, the grace, his grace is not sufficient for us, that what he said in 1 John 1:9 is not true, we're really saying God's grace is not enough. God is a liar. God didn't provide for me. When you believe those things and say that, that's why it says the fearful is one of the categories of people who will not enter the kingdom of heaven. The fearful, full of fear, doubt, and unbelief. That is a sin in itself, doubting the word of God, doubting the blood of Jesus, doubting the grace of God. That's a sin. Believe his word. If we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. In that same chapter 1, it says, and if we sin, we have an advocate with the Father. That's even our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He is the one who is our judge, our forgiver, and by his Spirit, he leads us to conviction to repent. God is doing all the work. All you're doing is offering yourself as a living sacrifice and going along with him. What I'm trying to tell you is what I wanted to start out with this video. saying, you know, singing to the Lord, because that's really the Lord. Even though you are not steadfast, and I am not steadfast, and our circumstances are not steadfast. We could have all kinds of troubles in our life. You know, your air conditioner could be broken. Your heater could be broken when it's cold. Your air conditioner broken when it's hot. You know, your teeth. You could have a toothache. Your feelings could come out, like what happened to my wife. You can have, your glasses can break. You can have your car won't start. You can have anything, whatever. You can have people slandering you and attacking you and trolling on you. You know, I have those trolls. Those of you guys that make videos, you have trolls, some of you who comment on the internet. You got people stalking you around the internet. All this crazy flesh and wickedness. But the Lord is steadfast. That's what I wanted to tell you. He's steadfast and unmovable. Hallelujah. And he's from beginning to end, everlasting to everlasting, the Alpha and Omega. His love never changes. His love never fails. Hallelujah. What is that? That's what I wanted to sing that song to you, because I know the Lord's releasing his anointing through this singing, because I can't sing. That's why God does that. He doesn't need performers. He doesn't need, you know, excellent singers. You know, the world loves to have performances. Brothers and sisters, I've been in lots of churches. And those of you who are spirit-filled, you can discern it when someone is performing for man or performing for the Lord. It's not a matter of, oh, you have such a great voice. No, it's the anointing. I don't want to hear someone who knows the words to a song. I want to hear someone who knows the origin of that song. I don't want to hear someone who can sing Amazing Grace. I want to hear someone who's lived Amazing Grace and experienced Amazing Grace. I don't want to hear someone quote about the Good Shepherd. I want to hear somebody who knows the Good Shepherd, who's walked with the Good Shepherd, who's lived the 23rd Psalm and John chapter 10. Hallelujah. For the Lord is my shepherd and I shall not want. Hallelujah. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Because thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Hallelujah. You lead me in the paths of righteousness for your name's sake. Hallelujah. You know, and it goes on to say, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Hallelujah. How about that? Goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Why? Because I'm being led by the Good Shepherd. He makes our cup to runneth over. He anointeth my head with oil, it says. That's the Holy Spirit and gladness. The Holy Spirit represents, the oil represents the Lord, the Holy Spirit, and gladness. Hallelujah. My cup runs over. What with blessings? Hallelujah. Just the other day, I met with a sister and prayed with her. That's the word that the Lord gave me for her, that her cup runneth over, and surely she would dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord God Most High. Even as King David wrote that 23rd Psalm, and he was a shepherd. He had to be a shepherd first, and then he became a king. Hallelujah. Jesus was a shepherd when he was on earth, and then he became a king. He's coming back as the King of Kings. Hallelujah. Praise God Almighty. I just wanted to throw that one out there. I don't know if I've ever shared that one in video. So many beautiful things the Lord showed me. King David also wrote the Psalm that said, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of the Lord. I'd rather be a servant in the house, you know, a slave in God's mansion than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. Hallelujah. To be in a good place and be somebody among wicked people, I'd rather be a servant and a slave and a nobody in the kingdom of God than somebody that's a somebody in this wicked world. Hallelujah. In the kingdom of Satan. Hallelujah. That's why I want to just pray the blessing of the Lord upon you and sing the blessing of the Lord. And just get this into your spirit. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Hallelujah. He is faithful who has called you and chosen you. Hallelujah. Because many are called, but few are chosen. If you are chosen to walk with the Lord, if you're chosen to go in the rapture, if you're chosen to be with God, Hallelujah. There's nothing better. There's nothing better. Hallelujah. To be chosen by God, that He called us by name. Hallelujah. Blessed be His name. His steadfast love. Hallelujah. God doesn't change. He's immovable. Hallelujah. 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 Fall on the rock of Yeshua HaMashiach. Cast yourself upon the Lord's mercy, upon His grace, for He is a good shepherd. Hallelujah. He will lead you in paths of righteousness for His name's sake. Hallelujah. For His own glory. Not about even about us, but about Him. Hallelujah. For His own glory, He will lead you in the right path. He who has begun a good work in you shall see it through to the end, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Fear not, for I am with you, the Lord said. Hallelujah. Fear not. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Hallelujah. For it's a Father's good pleasure, little flock, to give you the kingdom, the Lord Jesus Christ said. Fear not, little flock, for it's the Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Lord, hallelujah, has chosen us. Praise God. Why He would choose me? Even as David said again, King David, the shepherd, the good shepherd on earth. Jesus is a good shepherd above. Hallelujah. David is a type of Christ. When he wrote those psalms from the heart of God, by the Spirit of God, as Jesus said, David spoke by the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. He said all those things, brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. Praise be God Most High. Hallelujah. He is great and worthy to be praised. I want to thank the Lord for all He's done in my life. And I ask you to thank the Lord, as David wrote, we should enter His praises with thanks. We should enter His gates with thanksgiving in our heart. We should enter His courts with praise. You know, I will say this is a day that the Lord has made, and I will rejoice and be glad. Hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice, for He has made me glad. Hallelujah. Praise be God. Hallelujah. Most High, Creator of heaven and earth. He is worthy of all praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He is steadfast and immovable. He's immovable. That's why they call Him the rock, like the song Rock of Ages and all that's from the Bible. Jesus is the rock. Hallelujah. He is a rock of our salvation. He's steady in the storm. Hallelujah. As Jesus said, he who hears these sayings of mine, at the end of the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 7, Jesus said, he who hears these words of mine and obeys them is like someone who builds their house on a rock. Because the storm will come and the waves will come, but the house will still stand because it's built on a rock. He who hears these sayings of mine and does not keep them is like a man who builds his house on the sand. Hallelujah. And when the storms came and the waves came, it's knocked down. And great is the fall of that house. So that's why that song, there's an old song that's, I think it's a Presbyterian song, maybe. It's, I've sang this before. On Christ the solid rock I stand. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. I'm trying to remember how it goes. I haven't heard it in a while. Hallelujah. All other ground is sinking sand. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed be His name. I need to go find that song and play it again. Hallelujah. Find an anointed version of that song. There's many ones singing it. But it's, you know, you got to look and find one that's anointed by a singer who knows that Jesus is the rock, that's experienced Jesus as the rock of ages in their life. Like that old song, Rock of Ages. Hallelujah. He is the rock. Hallelujah. Blessed be His holy name. He is worthy. He is worthy of all praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed be His name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed be His name. I want to pray for you guys right now in the name of Jesus. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, we come before Your throne, Lord God. Hallelujah. Lord, hallelujah. We praise You, Lord. Hallelujah. You are worthy of all praise. Hallelujah. Lord, I ask You, Lord. Yes, Lord, we lift Your name on high. That's what I'm hearing in my spirit from the Lord. Lord, I lift Your name on high. Lord, I love to sing Your praises. I'm so glad You're in my life. I'm so glad You came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way. From the earth to the cross, my debt to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift Your name on high. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your holy name. Hallelujah. You give and take away. Yes, Lord. You give and take away. Yes, Lord. But my heart will choose to say, blessed be your name. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Father, just bless your people in the name of Jesus, Lord. Just release, Lord, the overflow of your blessings, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. I speak, Lord, revival on your church, on your bride, Lord. Hallelujah. I speak preparations be made for the bride to get ready to meet the Lord in the air. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I speak preparation time for the bride of Christ, that the body be awakened in Jesus' name. I speak it and release it. Awake thou that sleepest. Arise from the dead, and Christ shall give you life in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to his holy name. Hallelujah. Blessings and honor and praise unto our Lord and our God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed be his holy name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's another song. I don't really know the words. I've only heard it once or twice. I had to go back and find it. You know, the Lord will drop a song on you, and then when you sing it, you're releasing the anointing. Lord, the Lord is trying to get something to you through Bible verses. It's a rhema word, through a worship song. He's trying to get a message to you, brothers and sisters. When you start hearing those things, begin to sing it. You know, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run in to him, and they are saved. That's a psalm also. Hallelujah. And it also is referring and showing us that the Lord is a rock. He's our strong tower. He's our steadfast love. Hallelujah. He's him. He is the steadfast father. Hallelujah. Unlike earthly fathers, we can make changes in our minds. We can have, flip-flop on a decision and be a wishy-washy, as they say. But God is steadfast. Hallelujah. Immovable. Hallelujah. Unchanging. Hallelujah. The same yesterday, today, and forever. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He has loved us with an everlasting love, as it says in the Gospel of John. Hallelujah. He loved us so much that he gave himself for us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He gave himself for us, and whomsoever shall believe on him shall not perish but have everlasting life. Hallelujah. Blessed be his holy name. He is a righteous, glorious king. Hallelujah. Blessed be his name. Oh, how I love Jesus. That's another song too. I don't know why the Lord keeps doing that to me. Oh, how I love Jesus. I haven't heard that song since I was a kid in the Baptist church. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. I haven't heard that song since I went to Vacation Bible School, probably when I got saved, when I was probably 8 years old, brothers and sisters. I know I haven't heard that song in so many years. It's not even in my memory. That's how good God is. He can bring back. He can give you thoughts. He can give you words that you don't even know. What does he say in Jeremiah 33:3? Call upon me, and I will answer you, and I will show you great and mighty things that you know not. Hallelujah. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. God never ceases to amaze me. Yes, I'm so amazed. I'm so amazed. That's a Christian song I heard one time, a different version of it. There's a slower version of it. One time when I was in the Philippines at a hotel, you know, I was always stay at the same hotel when I went to Manila, like to do my wife's citizenship and all that. I did ministry work in Manila. Always went to the same hotel. And brothers and sisters, when I first started going there, the church was not really a Christian place. And then later on, the owner of the place is a Christian, and he owns about 5 or 6 hotels up there. And he plays Christian music in his hotels, and then they have a Bible study every day. They have a devotional at every one of his hotels about 5 o'clock. This place is called the Pinoy Pamilya Hotel. Hallelujah, there in Manila. Anyway, and I don't know if any of those guys are watching my videos or not, if they have time. They said they would before last couple times I was there visiting them and in Manila. But anyway, God bless all of you guys. God bless all of you guys. Anyway, as I was going to say, I've been having dreams and getting words when I've been praying. I think I said at the beginning of the video, you know, that it's time for the Lord to come back. Even today, the Lord gave me a word in a Filipino dialect, and he said it in a deep part that I didn't understand. I had to ask my wife. I didn't know what it meant. You know, you can pronounce words with a different tone on the different syllable. It can have totally different meanings. And the word I got was, I will see you soon. I will see you soon. But it was in the Filipino dialect, and I wasn't sure what I was saying. As a matter of fact, I had no idea exactly what I was saying. But anyway, so praise God, my wife, you know, I told her what I was saying, and while I was praying in spirit, and that's what she said the meaning of it is. So praise God. Praise God. The Lord is going to see us soon, And I'm ready to go, brothers and sisters. I don't want to be here any longer on this earth either. But while I'm here, to live is Christ and die is gain, the Apostle Paul said. You know, so to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And I want to be with him just as much as any of you guys. But I offer myself as a living sacrifice daily, try to crucify my flesh daily, to go forward to do his will, you know, and bring as many into the kingdom as I can through the YouTube and then the ministry we have in the Philippines. We have all those things, brothers and sisters. And yet every day, of course, the enemy tries to withstand me in all kinds of ways, as I mentioned. You know, it'll be in a season. That's how it works for me, and I think it works for most people. You go through a season, you know, and right now I've been going through a season of attack, and I just thought about it, and I asked you guys to pray for me, you know, because your prayers has really been such a blessing. And as the Bible says, one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight. And, you know, all these things coming at once, 100 different things. Like my wife had two feelings to fall out that she had gotten in the Philippines. Well, you know, you get, what can I say? Should I say anything else about the Philippines? But anyway, brothers and sisters, and 100 other things going on all at the same time. And it's just the way it goes. It's just the patterns that are done from the second heaven by Satan and his little minions on earth. And of course, God follows patterns. And I know that God has a much, you know, as Jesus says, as the good shepherd in John chapter 10, I've been talking about him being a good shepherd. Jesus said, the enemy comes not, but to kill, steal, and destroy. John chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. But I have come that you might have life and life abundantly. So when the enemy attacks us, as the Bible, another Bible verse says, when the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard against him. So the Lord, you know, raises up a standard. The Lord will, you know, in other words, if the devil takes, you know, tries to steal something from you, God will give you, you know, God will give you 10 things better than what was stolen from you. God is like that. He loves to bless his people. He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him, you know, and he loves to bless his people. But, you know, when we're going through those times of crisis, that's what, just like what I did in this video, you have to praise him in the storm. Like there's a song by Casting Crowns. I will praise you in the storm. Hallelujah. You know, you have to, and as it says in the Psalms, I will lift up mine eyes unto the hills. Where cometh my help? My help cometh from the Lord. Hallelujah. The Lord who made heaven and earth. Hallelujah. That's a great song. There's a choir version of that song that is just so awesome. That I, you know, when I first got in the ministry, Don Moen had this CD set they were advertising on TV, God Will Make a Way. And I asked, you know, my mom asked me what I wanted for Christmas, and I said that's what I wanted. They bought it for me, the God Will Make a Way DVD sets. And there's a version on those CDs, there's like four of them, of this I Will Lift Up My Eyes Under the Hill. I think it's Psalm 137 or 147 or 127. I can never remember. But it's awesome. And that version of the choir is an awesome version, brothers and sisters. A very high and lofty song. But you know, I thought about this too at that time. Because I started in a Baptist church. I was an assistant pastor in a Baptist church teaching Sunday school. The Lord filled me with his Spirit. And I was seeking after truth and more of God. Not just, oh, I'm saved and let's sit on our behind and keep talking, slapping each other on the back and saying, we're saved. Let's, you know, advance off of baby milk. Let's learn to walk, talk, and breathe and become mature in the stature of Christ, as it says in Ephesians chapter 4. Anyway, I thought about this as a joke when I got, you know, more into the Lord and into the truth of God. You know, the Don Moen song, God Will Make a Way. I thought, well, you know what the Baptist version of that song is. God can make a way. God might make a way. If it be his will, he might make a way. You know, that's the Baptist version of the song. But the truth is, God will make a way. Not he might make a way. He will make a way. Rivers in the desert will I see. Hallelujah. Heaven and earth may change, but his word still remains. He will do something new today. Oh, God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works it out in his own way. He will make a way for me. He will be my guide, hold me closely to his side. With love and strength for each new day, he will make a way for me. He will make a way. God bless you guys. You know, I'm just laughing because, you know, the Lord keeps giving me all these songs. But the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. You know, and sing unto the Lord a new song, the Bible says. Sing unto the Lord a new song. Hallelujah. This is a day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. You got to rejoice in the Lord. Celebrate the presence of the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. Celebrate the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Celebrate his presence. Hallelujah. He is mighty to save. Our God is mighty to save. He has conquered the grave. Jesus, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He has conquered the grave. Forever, author of salvation. My God is mighty to save. He has conquered the grave. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Bless his name, brothers and sisters. You just got to flow in his spirit. Get under the spot where the glory comes out. You got to flow in his spirit, and God will carry you along by his spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You want to get a word from God? You want to hear from God? You got to flow in the river of his love. You got to flow by faith. Worship and rejoicing. Enter his gates with thanksgiving in his heart, your heart. Enter his courts with praise. Hallelujah. You got to exalt the Lord our God. Then he will begin to, you know, you minister to the Lord by worshiping him, thanking him, praising him. And then he's going to minister back to you by his spirit. Hallelujah. Pour out a blessing that you cannot contain. Health, wealth, wisdom, peace, joy, and love. All those things. The fruit of the spirit. The gifts of the spirit. Hallelujah. The fruit of the spirit. Galatians chapter 5, verse 22 and 23. And do away with those fruit of the flesh. Everybody loves to keep blaming the devil. But a lot of that stuff is the fruit of your own flesh. The sin nature. Also in Galatians chapter 5. Go read Galatians chapter 5. You'll see the fruit of the Spirit and the fruit of the flesh, brothers and sisters. The fruit of his Spirit. Not, oh, I'm going to be good. I'm going to have joy. No. Supernatural fruit of the Spirit. Just like the gifts. People say, oh, I've got discernment. I've got this. No. There's the supernatural gift of interpretation. The supernatural gift. It's not from you. Not from your flesh, but from God. The gift of prophecy. Speaking in tongues. Gifts of healing. All this different kind of stuff. The nine different gifts listed. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, brothers and sisters. God pours those things out on us as we worship him, praise him, read his word, be thankful, be grateful, be holy, for I am holy, God says. Hallelujah. Deliver yourselves under the mighty hands of God. He will give you strength. Hallelujah. All to Jesus I surrender. Surrender it all to God. You know, the Lord has me keep going. All to Jesus I surrender. I surrender all. Hallelujah. All to thee, my precious Savior, I surrender all. Hallelujah. Surrender all to the Lord. Your heart, mind, soul, body, whatever, all those things. Surrender your car, surrender your finances. You know, all those people that talk junk about giving and all that, it's because money is their God. They have any excuse of why they don't want to give. Like I said in the video the other day, you give to Billy Graham, then they'll talk junk about Billy Graham. Okay, give to Benny Hinn. Okay, you talk junk about Benny Hinn. You know, go down the road and open a food bank in your own neighborhood and evangelize. Everybody comes in there. Go give door to door and give Bibles and pray with people. You know, use your money and your time and your effort to go do it. Stop making excuses. Stop using your old flesh and old lies from the enemy. Hallelujah. God so loved the world, what? That he gave his only begotten son. God gives. People talk junk about somebody getting a word. God spoke a word, all of his Bible. My word will not pass away. God spoke, let there be life. Let there be light, and there was light. God speaks and into existence. The Bible says God says those things that are not as if they are. Like he said to Abraham, you're going to become not Abram, but Abraham, father of many nations. And Abraham had no children. He's 75 years old. His wife was 65. No children. And God said, okay, you're no longer going to be Abram, but Abraham, which means father of many nations. God speaks those things that are not as if they are. Romans chapter 4. That's where the text I'm quoting from, talking about Abraham from Genesis. Brothers and sisters, this is the way God operates. People talk about, his preacher just want people to give, you know, and all. God gave. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. The word agape, God so loved, John 3:16 I'm talking, God so agape'd the world. God so sacrificially gave and loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Agape means sacrificial giving love. That's why when the King James uses the word charity, in Paul, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, without charity, I'm nothing. That's a great word. It's like the verb of love. It's agape. A great word in English is charity. Giving sacrificial love. You know, in English we just have love. In Greek, there's like five or six different forms of love. You know, phileo love, you know, that's fraternities, fraternal love, you know, familial love, love in your family, eros, erotic love between a man and a woman in procreation, hopefully, as a husband and wife, those kind of different loves. And then there's agape love, God's giving sacrificial love. God so sacrificially gave to the earth that he gave his only begotten son. So God gives. God's acts are to give, to speak and to give, to speak and to give. You want to be like Christ? The Bible says, you know, to be, God wants to conform us to the image of Christ, to be like God. We're supposed to be in the image, as Adam and Eve were in the image of God. We're supposed to be in the image of God. God's not, you know, going around doing all this wicked stuff and taking and taking and taking. The devil comes but to kill, steal, and destroy. I should have made a whole nother video, but I have to wait for the Lord to flow in his spirit, brothers and sisters. John chapter 10, again, the enemy comes not but to kill, steal, and destroy. So when you're killing, stealing, and destroying with your tongue and physically in all these ways, you're doing the work of the devil. But when you come to give life and a life abundantly, when you speak life and God's love and all those things and the gospel and all those things, you are being like Christ. That's what the Bible tells us to do, to be conformed to the image of Christ. So to give your time, your love, your energy, your advice, your wisdom, your words, your money, all of those things is being like God, being Christ-like. All those things, when you give, sacrificially give. That's why Jesus said when you have a feast, don't invite, as I mentioned in the last video, don't invite those rich people who can pay you back and politicians to make a pourpoire and all this kind of stuff. But Jesus said when you have a banquet, invite the maimed, the halt, the lame. You know, back in those days, there wasn't no welfare. There wasn't all this stuff. They couldn't even go into the temple. If you were a man and you weren't spotless, you couldn't go into the temple. You know, these people are, you know, they're just had to bum on the streets because there ain't no welfare. You know, see what I'm saying? These people are beggars. Invite those people. You know, so when I have a feast and I'm feeding all those people, it's just out of my own wealth, my own desire to serve others, to bless, be like God, because you were a beggar. You are maimed. You are halt. You're lame in your sin. But God so loved you that he gave the banquet feast to you who could never pay him back. You know, this is really a good word from the Lord. I should make a separate video. God gave everything. You are lame, maimed, and halt, and unworthy, a beggar, full of dirt, a dirty, nasty, stinking beggar on the street when God found you and gave Christ for you. Never forget whence ye came. Never forget the pit that the Lord took you out of. That's why you have to be forever grateful. That's what, there's another song, I'm forever grateful. I can't remember the words now. Praise God to whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all ye creatures here below. Praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Blessed be the name of the Lord God Most High, Creator of heaven and earth. Hallelujah. 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 Blessed be his name. Hallelujah. Heaven, you know, earth and the flesh didn't reveal these things unto you, brothers and sisters. But my Father who is in heaven has revealed to you that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, the Lord God Almighty. What did Peter, you know, when Peter said you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, Jesus said, you know, God revealed this to you and every one of us who are born again. God revealed it unto us. If you're a truly born again Christian, you're only born again because God revealed it unto you. Just like me, I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. Hallelujah. I was lost and without hope, a wretched, blind fool, a thief, a liar, an adulterer, all those things combined, plus a more that I can't even remember, all the things that I've done and you've done in our lives. But yet God in his mercy redeemed us and picked us up out of the miry clay. Blessed be his name, brothers and sisters. God Most High. Hallelujah. He is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. God bless you guys. I keep going along with my videos. Praise God. This is what the Lord wants me to do. Brothers and sisters, I pray, you know, I still have some copies of my book. Not that many. They've been going. I praise God for this book, the wisdom he gave me in this book. If you'd like a copy, please let me know. The website link is below, and I'll send you a signed copy, you know, and by the grace of God, you can read it have time to read it. It's a call for revival, and it's, you know, praise God. I know the Lord is using this book, you know, to support orphanages, and also that the Lord would open doors that I can get into churches. You know, churches need to hear it. Like I said, I'll be going to a church on Sunday, brothers and sisters, a Methodist church. They need to hear the gospel message. You know, all these churches I've been to, they want me to talk about the orphans so they can feel like they're doing something good by donating to the orphans. But, you know, what good does it do to donate to the orphans if you're not saved? You know, I'm talking to those guys who are saved. Yeah, you need to give to whatever the Lord leads you, whether it be orphans or whether it be whatever, Billy Graham or whatever you think, whatever the Lord is leading in your heart to do. You know, that's between you and the Lord. But we should give to the work of God, whatever it is. Our tithes should be sown into the kingdom of God. Even like I said, you could walk down the street and buy your tithes worth of Bibles and go around handing them out and evangelize people. It's for the kingdom of God, whatever the Lord leads you to do, whatever it may be. But when I go to those churches, brothers and sisters, most of the time there's lots of people ain't even, they're not even born again. So it's like, even though the orphanages are important, even though these children need to be fed and we're evangelizing them and teaching them about the Lord and all that, but, you know, I always end up preaching the gospel. And most of the churches I went to after I preached, the leadership was really mad at me. None of them ever, they told me when I got there, oh, the deacons told me, oh, we're looking for a missionary to sponsor. We're going to sponsor you. After I got done preaching, they were glad to see me leave. Just like what I did in this video. That's why I talked there. All the places I've been. And in all those places, they, you know, there was no sponsorship coming out of those churches. And home, people's houses. I went to somebody's house in Louisiana. You know, and I didn't come there talking about the orphans. I came there talking, that's what they thought, maybe. I started talking about the Word of God. And I know some, a lot of them, almost all of them, but one or two, was all been out of shape, brothers and sisters, at the truth. But I don't care. I don't care. The God will be the one to provide for the orphanages and all that. But I do believe the Lord will use the book that I wrote. I got to write another book by June that it would open the doors. And I ask you, brothers and sisters, to support that and help me with that. As a matter of fact, maybe you can take, if you want to get some books and hand them out. There's one sister who hands out, you know, puts out books at the airport and doctor's offices and things like that. Two sisters, as a matter of fact. So God bless you guys. I love you guys. I thank you for watching my videos. And, you know, I'm just trying to do and be led by the Lord. Say what the Lord wants me to say. That's it. Simply, you know, and do His will against all the odds of the flesh and attacks and, you know, all the nonsense that goes on in the world, brothers and sisters, you know, to overcome those things and by just walking by faith and praising the Lord and thanking the Lord. And then He gives us the victory. We go through those seasons, brothers and sisters, of valleys and hills. You know, even the valley is higher ground. Satan can't touch me where God's love abounds. That's another song. That's a Southern gospel song. You know, even the valley is higher ground. Satan can't touch me where God's love abounds. Hallelujah. God's hand, there's no place where God's hand can't reach down. Even the valley is higher ground. Name of songs, Even the Valley. By the McCameys, I think. I can't remember. Tally Trio or the McCameys. Anyway, it's called Even the Valleys. Or Even the Valley. God bless you guys. I love you guys. I'll see you soon. And the anointing oil has been an overwhelming response for the anointing oil. You know, just pray about that too. That I can keep it all organized. I got it on my computer, the mailing list and all that. And ask you guys to keep praying about that. And any of you want oil, let me know. I'm going to start mailing out the second week of November. Still praying over the oil. I'm going to make another video praying over some bottles of oil too before I pour them into the vials. So God bless you guys. I'll see you soon. Love you guys. God loves you, of course, more than me. And that's what counts, not me, but God loves you. God died for you. He died for me. That's number one, brothers and sisters. God bless.